How are you? Welcome again and more American cooking. This time, I want us to think together about the Pennsylvania Dutch. You know, they are not Dutch. They never have been. They came from Germany, and they came so far back in American history that, that I want you to think of them not as foreigners, of course, but as a part of the American culture. The wonderful thing about America is that we have so many cultures that have kind of woven in with one another. And the Pennsylvania Dutch are one of these. They came here in the late 1600s. Thousands and thousands of them came from Germany. They were German Protestants, and they'd been persecuted in Germany in the most difficult ways. So they all kind of wound up in one area in Pennsylvania, and they were called Deutsch, which, of course, is a German word for German itself, Deutsch, in Deutschland, you see. And Americans began to call them Dutch, and because they all lived in Pennsylvania, they took on the name Pennsylvania Dutch, which is a strange change of the title. A lot of them came from the Rhine Valley, and this had been ravaged by the 30 Years' War, and then Louis XIV moved in. Terrible things happened. They lost their farms, their crops were burned on purpose. That's what happens to people who are misunderstood by those around, and they were treated terribly. First of all, the Mennonites came, and then the Amish, and the Dunkards, and the Schwenkfelders, the Moravians, on and on, so that by 1763, there were 280,000 Germans who had been persecuted in Germany living in one enormous area in Pennsylvania. A lot of them were in villages just outside of Philadelphia, in Allentown. Thousands were there. And later in Lancaster. I've been to Lancaster County. If you haven't been there, you must go. Wonderful food and charming people. Now, part of the Pennsylvania Dutch lifestyle as a religious practice was self-denial, that you kept things in order. You keep your priorities straight. But thank goodness, the term self-denial never has applied to their food. Do you know why? Because when their crops were burned, when they were wiped out in Germany and then came to the New World, food, you see, became very important. As it did with the Jews who had traveled and been persecuted for so long, food becomes terribly important, so you have great festivals. And there's a word in the Pennsylvania Dutch tongue, I have to look at it again because my German is terrible, it's called Feinschmeckers. They call themselves Feinschmeckers, and it means those people who know good food and know how to eat plenty of it. Now, that could only come from a background in which things were really difficult. Well, in any case, for that reason, food was very, very important in the New World. I have some wonderful things to bring to you today. One of them is the story of the Easter egg. Did you know, for you young people, did you know that that came from the Pennsylvania Dutch? They brought it with them from Germany because the religious festivals all had great feasts involved. And feasting means memory, you remember? So there were religious overtones to all sorts of dishes, and we had wonderful things such as the Easter egg. Another thing that's wonderful in the Amish community, I want you to see some beautiful quilts. The Amish spend a great deal of time doing things by hand and remembering. And the Amish were part of that Dutch community. Mrs. Karen Wallum, a good friend who has a German background and has loaned me her son, he's one of my chefs, has presented us these just for today. These are all handmade quilts. This is a fascinating pattern. And they sit and do this by hand. You know whether it's handmade because you look in the bottom and it's the same as it is in the top. Look at this beautiful thing. And this pattern I think is enormously attractive. Look at how many different pieces she has and how long she must have collected the fabrics. The Pennsylvania Dutch have a great deal of patience, almost to the point of, well, for me, it's hard to understand. My lifestyle is not loaded with a lot of patience. But I salute the Mittmans, one of my friends, they're Schwenkfelders. She was a Schwenkfelder. He was a classmate of mine in college. And his mama, bless her heart, she's gone now, but his mama used to use strange Pennsylvania Dutch phrases when she would feed us. She would say, we'd stay overnight, and she would say, "Don't forget to close the light." Close the light? You see, that's a weird cross between German and English, and you wind up with all sorts of wonderful things. I went to their wedding, to Russell and Ruth Mittmans. It was the longest wedding I've ever been to, and I was an usher. It must have taken 3 days. I don't remember. But it was a Schwenkfelder wedding, and it was in Pennsylvania. And the feasting was wonderful, so we had a great time. Now, let's get down to some cooking. First dish I want to do for you today is very, very typical of the German influence that's found in the area, and it's a duck cooked in sauerkraut. Are you ready for that one? Wonderfully easy to do. First of all, I have a kettle, and I want to put in my kettle one duck. And I've pre-roasted him a bit. in the oven, not very long, but there we are. I better move things out of here so we can see what we're doing here today. I put him in a 375 degree oven for about 25, 30 minutes, maybe a little hotter oven if you like. There you go. The 400 wouldn't hurt because you just want to brown him, but you don't want to cook him. So you see the duck is browned. He's still a bit red inside. You see the blood inside the duck is still just a little bit pink. Anyhow, put him into a tight-fitting kettle. And boy, that's tight-fitting, isn't it? We'll just push him right down in there. There we go, tight-fitting kettle. And we want to put some sauerkraut in on him. Now, sauerkraut, wonderful thought. So I'm going to put some of the kraut down the bottom. I'm going to use about 2 quarts. And then we'll add a few other ingredients, but it's nothing complicated. And then we're going to simmer this or bake it in the oven. I like to bake mine. Now we'll just push some of that kraut right underneath the old bird here. And the other quart will go on top. Sit down. There we are. The other quart will go on top. There we go. And then to that we're going to add a couple of yellow onions. You can use them whole or you can add them sliced. Does this sound like Germany to you now? Or look like Germany? Sauerkraut, onions, a bit of sugar, some pepper, and a duck. You know what the name of the duck, the dish is? Duck mit Kraut, yeah? I don't know what the name, what is duck in German? I don't remember. I took German for years and years, and it was years and years ago, so the only thing I can do now is to go to Germany and find a restaurant, and I think that's all that matters. Now, I want to add a cup of water. Just throw in a cup of water. There we go. Pour it right over the top. Just a little additional moisture for our duck, you see. And about 3 tablespoons of brown sugar. Just sprinkle it on top. And some black pepper. And on that one, I simply have to say, to taste. Oh, this is so good. Because the kraut, you know, has an ability to tenderize just anything. Literally, it'll tenderize the kettle if you cook it long enough. There it is. A little bit of pepper. We don't need salt, of course, because the sauerkraut itself is full of salt. And we have a couple of medium onions. I have a big one that I've just cut up into quarters. Put the lid on that. Do you get the whole recipe now? A couple of quarts of kraut, 1 duck that you've roasted at 400 for about 25 or 30 minutes, a couple of small onions, a cup of water, 3 tablespoons of brown sugar, pepper to taste. Put the lid on this rascal and bake him at 325 for about an hour and a half. I'll set him aside and I have one all ready for you. Remember to use a tight-fitting pot. That is to say, a pot that is not going to... Oh, good Lord. Auf Gehaven. This is a heavy pot. Remember to use a pot that the things will fit in tightly so that... And there is a duck in there somewhere. So that you don't have the duck wandering around in all of that sauerkraut. You see, don't have it all spread out. We'll dish him out a little bit later on because I have lots of things I want you to see. Get the heat up here. This next one is so simple. My mother used to make this when I was a little kid, and she had no Pennsylvania Dutch background at all. But it's pickled eggs. And they're wonderful for picnics. They're wonderful for salads. They're just wonderful for a day because the Pennsylvania Dutch insist on 7 sweets and 7 sours at each at a formal dinner, you see, a formal family meal. And that means that you need to make up a couple of sours. Oh, I forgot something. Hold it before we go on. The other thing that you need to serve along with your, and I had it already, along with your duck, is mashed potatoes. And I remember to do this because when my wife, Patty, lived in Brooklyn as a kid, she used to eat with Germans off and on, and they would smear the mashed potatoes and the sauerkraut together. She still thinks that's heaven. It's a wonderful dish. So serve this traditionally with mashed potatoes, sauerkraut, and duck. And then I like to add a green salad and lots of beer and that sort of thing. Then you have a good time. Okay, pickled eggs. Here we go. We have 8. This is so simple, it's absurd. We have 8 hard-boiled eggs. I'm going to put them into a crock. They're all peeled, you see, ready to go. Then to that, I'm going to add some onions, sliced onions. There we are. What am I using? Oh, I don't know, 3 or 4 slices. This depends on how strong you want these to be with onion. This really is a pickle that we're making. And then we're going to add some pickled beets. So just throw them in there. I'm using about 1.5 jars or 1.5 pints. You can guess on that any way you like. And there should be enough juice in there, and this will work fine, to cover the eggs. And then just cap them up and put them in the refrigerator for, oh, a couple of days if you like them really dark, one day if you don't like them so dark, and I'll show you what you have. If you've not seen pickled eggs, I feel sorry for you, but when I was a kid, this was a very special treat. Let's see if we can find some in here that... come here, eggs. Get out of there. Isn't the color bizarre? Isn't that wonderful? There should be several in here, and we'll just... And they're served along with the beets. At least I like mine along with beets. As a kind of a salad side course or a pickle course. Remember the line, seven sweets and seven sours. Now you're going to ask me, is this a sweet or a sour? Well, there's vinegar in it, so it's a sour. And then we'll have sweet pickles as well. Okay. Is that enough eggs for you? I did a dozen in this one, and I did eight in the recipe I gave you, but that's all right. A little juice will not hurt. There we go. So we'll put this out. Wow, I don't want to put these on that red cloth. It'll just look awful. You have to be careful with colors. I think foods look particularly bad on blue. Blech. One afternoon, Alfred Hitchcock threw a dinner party in which he made everything blue. Everything was blue. Blue mayonnaise, blue soup, blue wine, blue milk. People, well, they couldn't eat. Colors are very important. All right, the next one. Yes, we're ready. Liver dumplings in Berlin are very important, and the Germans brought that whole image of a liver dumpling to this country, and in Schwenkfelder County, in Schwenkfelder Company, they're made this way. I have, oh boy, I have run out of room today already, and it's an early time. There we go. I have 1.5 pounds of liver, and I've ground it up rather coarsely. Oh, listen, you young kids, stop. Don't give me any more yuckies. If you don't like liver dumplings, you've missed out on a wonderful thing. So just cool down and give me a break here, will you? Then I want to add to that two eggs. And I'm going to beat the eggs first because I don't want to tear up the liver anymore. So I've run it to a rather medium blade in my grinding. There we go. I had these one night in Berlin about in 1960, about 3 months before the Berlin Wall was put up. And the woman that made them for me, along with a couple of other friends, she was the wife of a very famous cellist who was also the conductor of the Berlin Symphony.